Hi YouTube, Michigan Snow Pony Renee, and today's video is going to be on dairy goats, specifically udders. What makes a good udder, what makes a not so good udder, and what are udders to avoid? Because many of the questions I get off my YouTube channel are regarding getting into dairy goats, and people are a little bit stumped and overwhelmed with what they should be looking for and looking at. So I'm just going to start with the most important part, at least to me, is the mammary system, and give you a few things to look for and to watch out for, okay? And this is Grace. She's our two-year-old milker out of Marty. This is her second lactation. She did have kids, or a kid, as a yearling. We'll get to that further in the video about breeding. And she's going to be my live model, and please cut me a little slack today because I'm probably going to have quail roosters crowing in the background from time to time and other animals making noises. I am in a barn and we're on a farm, so I'll try to keep the distractions to a minimum, but no guarantees. Okay, I got my notes here. That's the other thing. I'm trying to juggle three different things. We're going to just talk about when you go to look at your goat, you're going to want to go at milking time, because to best assess a dairy animal, you need to see a full udder. So when you arrive, you're going to stand from the side like I am, and I'm running into the barn here, so I can't get as further over as I'd like to. But you're going to look at that udder from the side, and you're going to see, hopefully, what they call the rule of thirds. And if you do any research on selecting dairy animals, you're going to come across that rule. And what it means is, oh good, she squared up a little better, is you should see a third of that udder behind her rear leg, a third of the udder covered up by her rear leg, and a third of her udder in front of her rear leg. And you should also see the teats from the side. If you see that, that's a pretty good start. And also, I want you to sit next to her and feel along her belly, okay? You should feel a very prominent, close to the skin, vein. It should be like an inch or so wide, and that's the milk vein. Very important. It supplies the blood flow to the mammary system, and you want to feel that. You also want to slide your hand up where the udder meets the belly. Your fingers, let me trade hands here, should not go into a pocket. You know, you shouldn't lose your fingers. It's okay if, like, the very fingertips, if there's a little bit of an indent there, but there, you shouldn't go up to your knuckles or anything like that. That is regarding the fore attachment of the udder. And ideally, that udder should just flow right up into the belly and then the belly continue. There shouldn't be any little pocket that you can slide your hands into. If there is and it's not a deep one, no big deal. But just know it's not the ideal, okay? All right, after you do that, oh, and one more thing. After you're touching this strange goat all over, she's probably going to react to that and dance around. Don't think she's unfriendly. She just doesn't know you, okay? Now, after you assess from the side, yes, Grace, I know, we're going to go to the back, and hopefully this isn't too dark, and hopefully it's not blurry. Let me stop and start here. Oh, there it goes. Okay. And you're going to look at the goat straight on from the back, which Grace, of course, is standing cockeyed, but, and what you should see is a groove down the middle of that udder, butt cheeks, if you will. Ideally, equal butt cheeks. Now Grace, you can see, is a little bit bigger on the right than the left. So that's not the ideal, but she's not too bad. You should also see the teats from the back. And if you look at the shape of the udder, and when it meets the body, oh, I knew that was going to happen. That's quail crowing. You should see an upside down U. You don't want to see a V shape. You want to see a U shape. And she should have a really wide stance. That's a good dairy goat right there. Now, like I say, she moves away. Grace should be more equal, but she's not. She still gives good amount of milks. And for a homestead animal, that's not too bad. She won't win in the show ring, but that's not too bad for the homestead. Okay? Now, if you're looking at a doeling or a goat that hasn't been bred, if you stand behind him, of course, there's no udder to look at, but you want to see a really wide stance, because that means that that goat's framework is going to allow her to have a nice big udder back there someday. It's not going to limit that. So that's how you can assess a little doeling from standing behind her, one of the ways. Another thing you want to take note of is how low does that udder hang. Yes. You do not want to see teats at the level of the hock. That's the bend. They're her knees, if you will, right here. You don't want to see the udder getting down to that point, especially on a younger doe. Now, age and gravity does take its toll on udders. And so if you're looking at an older doe and it's starting to get down to that point, not too bad. But on a two-year-old, no, you don't want to see them down there. And the reason is, if the udder hangs too low, that refers to the attachments. The attachments probably aren't that great. And theoretically, as she gets up and down, she might step on her own teats and damage them. So that's why you don't want a real low udder, okay? Now, teat size, speaking of teats. I can't go to that side. I'll get dark. I'm so used to standing on the other side. Teat size to me is very important. Not so much the American Dairy Goat Association, but we'll get to that later. You should know, especially if you're looking at a first freshener or a very young doe who's a first freshener, that means she gave birth for the first time. Teat size increases as a doe matures, especially after that very first pregnancy. And so if you're looking at a doe and her teats are very small and difficult to milk, be a little bit lenient with that, because chances are on her subsequent pregnancies and lactations, that's going to increase. Her teat size is going to increase and she'll be easy to milk. That was the case with Grace. Last year she was just tedious to milk. Her teat size were so small. This year she's easy peasy. So teat size does increase as long as you're not starting out, you know, with extremely small teats, you know. So cut them a little slack. Now shape of the teats is important. You don't want long skinny fingers. What you want are what I call wedge-shaped teats. Now, I personally like them to be a little more finger-shaped than triangular. But the show ring likes the triangular-shaped big bulbous teats, okay? I find that the bigger teats are small, are harder for kids to grab onto, especially newborn kids. So I don't like them, Grace. I don't like them as big as what the show ring does. But that's a personal preference. You just want something that's long enough to get your hand around to milk and big enough that you don't feel like you're losing it when you close your fingers around it, okay? Also important is the angle of the teats. As I mentioned, when you're standing behind, you want to see those teats. If you don't, that means they're angled probably too far forward. And they're kind of like this instead of like this. They're like that. That's not good, because if you've ever tried to milk a goat like that, when you're milking, at least in my experience, that milk will squirt right up your sleeve or up your arm. They're very hard to aim, in my opinion. And we had a goat like that. Here, take a look. That was Bella. Lena didn't mind milking her. I hated the angle on those teats. So you want them pointing, for the most part, downward. A little bit of a forward angle isn't too bad, but not as far as like what Bella's were. Just a little bit. Ideally, they point down, okay? All right, placement. The teats should also not be so wide apart from each other that they touch the sides of the goat's legs. And or they're pointing at them like east and west, you know? And here is a picture of teats from the ADGA, American Dairy Goat Association's linear appraisal form, to give you an idea. Now, another thing you should be aware of is orifice size. In other words, the opening that the milk comes out of. And that is very important. And what you'll commonly hear people refer to is, oh, this goat expresses well. How well that milk comes out and how easily it comes out, the orifice, and easy to milk, is how well the goat expresses. So if you hear that term, that's what they're referring to. And that can really vary. And unlike teat size, orifice size does not change much as the goat matures. What you start out with is pretty much what you're going to have. So if you've got this little thready, thin stream that can get really old to milk because it's going to take you longer and you're going to feel like, oh my gosh, I'm not getting anywhere. Whereas a goat that has a nice, heavy, thick stream, that can make milking so much easier and just a breeze. Here's a picture of two different kinds of streams, and I think you'll see the difference. Now another factor concerning orifice size is if they're too small and you're leaving your baby goats on your does, which a lot of people do, as the baby goats get mature or age, they're going to want more and more milk, and they're going to get frustrated if they can't get it out. And they're going to get very aggressive, or some of them can, especially the butt kids, with bunting and really going after mama's udder, trying to get more milk out. And they can actually damage the udder when they get close to weaning time. So be aware of that. And at the other end of the spectrum, regarding orifice size, if they're too large and the milk drips out when it gets close to milking time, that's not good either, because that means the opening is open and all kinds of little nasties can crawl right up there and take residence in your goat's milking system as far as germs and viruses and bacteria. And that's not good either. Now, if you're late getting to milking and your goat's really full and really tight and maybe she's streaming a little bit here and there, that happens at fair because the show goes late and then all the goats want to be milked out. That's different. I mean on a day-to-day routine business. Your goat should not stream milk. Should not be dripping milk. Those orifices are too big, okay? Even on a heavy milker, that shouldn't happen. Now, I mentioned the American Dairy Goat Association. They actually have a scorecard, and I'm going to put a snapshot of it in here so you can see how they critique and judge goats. And this will help you kind of know what's important, at least to the show ring. Maybe not to the homesteader in all cases, but it gives you a good starting point. So here, take a look at it and then go ahead and look it up online where you can probably see it better. Now that brings up the show ring perfection versus a worthy homestead animal. And usually, yeah, they can be one and the same. But not always. You'll notice from that scorecard that the mammary system is worth 35% or 35 points out of 100. And teats only constitute 4 points or 4% of that. So they really don't weigh teat size and teats in general very heavily. And as someone who hand milks a lot, I do. That's important to me. And it's usually important to many homesteaders who hand milk. I do have a manual milking machine, but 9 times out of 10, especially if I only have 2 goats to milk, I'm gonna just hand milk because it's a pain to clean that up. Or I'm too lazy to do it. So teat size is important, and so that's where I think sometimes the homesteader and the showroom person part ways, because what we weigh or factor in as important isn't necessarily what the show ring does. And another thing you should look at is if a goat does really well in the show ring and, oh, she's won all kinds of awards and taken first place and blah, blah, blah. Keep in mind, the mammary system only constitutes 35% of the total score. That means farms who are big into showing and go to the national shows and that, they have 65% of other things to concentrate on in their breeding program. And so, you know, they may not always put a heavy emphasis on what you do. And personally, I know of 2 people who go to the national shows, Gracie, she's getting bored, and are big into showing goats, and they don't even drink their own goat's milk. In other words, yeah, they're not really concerned with capacity and taste. They just want the animal to look a certain way. So keep that in mind. There's something else you should be aware of, and that's a meaty, M-E-A-T-Y, udder. And that means an udder that has a lot of fibrous connective tissue. And those udders, even when milked out, will still look a little full. Grace actually has a meaty udder. She has good capacity, but she has a lot of connective tissue in there. And the show people kind of like that because it always makes the udder look full and nice. But it may not be something a homesteader is interested in because you want all that udder to be filled with milk, not connective tissue so much or fibrous tissue. So just keep that in mind. So a less than ideal appearing udder for the show ring It might produce incredible amounts of milk and be attached to the perfect homestead dairy animal. You just gotta take each animal as you're looking at it, and that's something we'll get into a little later too, rather than breed. Now, a lot of times people ask me, how much milk am I going to get from this goat? A full-size dairy animal, Alpine, Saanen, Toggenburg, La Mancha, etc., they're going to give you between 1 gallon and 2 gallons a day, just based on a lot of different factors, but genetic speaking. And that's at their peak lactation. Now, when is that? That's, in my experience, about 5 to 6 weeks into their lactation, 5 to 6 weeks after they kid. That's when they're really pouring it on heavy, okay? And a lot of people ask me, too, which breed produces the best milk? Every breed and no breed. What I mean by that is it's not a breed-by-breed thing. It's a goat-by-goat thing, okay? So don't say, well, I don't want that breed because I've heard their milk tastes bad, or I want this breed because I've heard their milk is the best. Judge the individual animal before you. If you take nothing away from this video, take that little gem away. It's goat by goat, not breed by breed. Now, where it gets a little confusing is there are breeds who are known for high production, and there are breeds who are known for high butterfat. And butterfat tends to make the milk taste sweeter. Now, the goats with the highest butterfat, generally speaking, not always, are the Nigerian dwarf and the Nubians. So a lot of people say their milk tastes the best. Well, not every Nubian and every Nigerian dwarf will have high butterfat like they're supposed to. And you'll run into Alpines that do have high butterfat more than they're supposed to. We had one. It just depends. So also don't believe all the what I call the goat gossip. You'll often hear that Toggenbergs have terrible milk. Well, the breed would have died out if that were true. So obviously there are individuals within the breed that don't have bad milk. And, so again, take it goat by goat. Look at the animal before you. Let me look at my notes here, see what I'm missing. We're getting to the end, guys. Wake up. That's why it's so important, too, to come at milking time so that you can taste the milk of the goat you're considering. That's probably key. There's no sense buying a goat that you go, ooh, And if you're buying a doling or a baby that you can't taste her milk, look around and say, do you have her mother? They should have her mother on site, or her auntie or her sisters. See if you can taste their milk. At least that'll give you some idea of what she might produce. Okay, so we've talked about the breed thing, and that kind of brings me to the whole idea of crossbreds. I'm not going to tell you not to buy a crossbred, but I'm going to put some caveats on that. Only buy if you absolutely know and trust the person. Don't do a Craigslist buying a crossbred thing. Why? Because you can't always look at the goat and tell what it is. Even if the person's saying, well, yeah, this is two dairy breeds bred together, and she's wonderful, and blah, blah, blah. For example, Nubians have the floppy ears, right? So do Boer goats. Boer goats are a meat breed. So if you breed a Boer goat to an Alpine, you might get a very Nubian-looking goat. But they're only one half dairy, the other half's meat. They probably are not going to be a high production animal for you. So same thing with the Nigerian dwarfs versus a pygmy. They don't look alike with the purebreds, at least not to my eyes. But if you breed a full-size goat to a pygmy goat, you're going to get this mid-sized goat, just like you would with a Nigerian, which is a dairy breed, and a pygmy is a meat breed. So you're going to get this mid-sized goat that the people can tell you, yeah, two dairy breeds mixed together. But it's not. It's a meat breed and a dairy breed. Again, it's going to affect your milk. So only buy those crossbreeds if you are really sure of the person that you're buying from. And a little bit beyond genetics is the importance of nutrition. If you feed junk in, you're going to get junk out, no matter how well-bred the goat is. So you really need to study nutrition and to get the best tasting and highest quantity of milk in your milk pail. And that's a whole nother video for another day. Other factors that influence milk production our stress. If an animal gets stressed out being overcrowded or whatever, usually the production slacks off. So if you go to see a goat and it seems like this is not a good situation for the goat, boy, their production's a little lower than what I would like, you might be able to bring it up simply by removing the goat from the bad situation. No guarantees, but something to think about. How many kids did they have? Usually the more kids they deliver, the higher the production. That makes sense, doesn't it? Consistent milking practices. If the farm milks, you know, twice a day, 12 hours apart, just very, very consistently, that's going to keep your production up, and that's what you should do as well when you bring the goat home. And also the goat's age. Usually the older they get, a little more or a little less production you're going to get out of them with each lactation. And I mean that in an older goat, like past the age of 7 or 8, that their production does tend to go down. Not always, but generally. Now, if you're going to buy a dry doe, well, what's a dry doe? A dry doe is a goat that is not currently in milk. And it might be a young goat that's never been bred, or it might be a goat that's too young to be bred, or it might be a goat that's dried off. She's had her kids. Maybe the people didn't want to milk in the winter, so they dried her off. Stop that, Gracie. Or maybe she's been a pet for the first 3 years of her life. Those are all legitimate reasons to be dry. However, if you're looking at a four-year-old goat and they've tried to get her bred and they just can't, that's a goat with issues. Or she's never carried to term and delivered babies, that's a goat to walk away from fast because something's not right with her and she probably should be culled, in all fairness. You're also going to run across every now and then what they call precocious milkers. These might be goats that have never been bred, but they come into milk. Sometimes they don't come into milk both sides of the udder. Sometimes it's just one side, or sometimes it's both sides. They aren't going to give as high a production as they could. Sorry, my camera just shuts itself off. I don't know why. Every now and then it will do that. So anyway, it just doesn't work that way, that the babies always are as good as their mothers. Not always. Sometimes they're better, but... So when you buy a doling, and that's a great way to start because they're cheaper and you can get some really good bloodlines that way. You can buy hopefully a higher quality animal than you could buying a doe in milk. But look at, if you can, her mature female relatives on the farm that are in milk. Look around, see if there's consistency in the udders. Hopefully the udders don't look like this. And if all the udders on the farm look pretty good, then they've probably got a pretty good breeding program going on. They know what they're doing. And also, if you can, taste her mother's milk or her sister's milk or whoever you can. If you like that milk, well, that's a good chance that you're going to like this little girl's milk. And if you don't like the milk, well, there might be a chance that you don't like her milk either. At least it gives you an idea. And then one more thing about buying dolings. And this is milk stand manners, because when you buy a baby, you're going to have to teach her to get on the milk stand, all that fun stuff. And people like to make a big deal out of it, you know, teaching the goat milk stand. It's not. It's so easy, guys, because when you bring that little goat home, you should already have one of these, a milk stand. Yes, you should. That's right, Grace. You're going to use this whether you're milking or not. You're going to use it to trim hooves, veterinary care, worming, giving them a bath or clipping them if they're going to go to the fair. These things are invaluable, and if you don't have one, you're making your life a whole lot harder than it has to be. So when you get her home, put goodies in the tray or in the feed pan and just teach her. You get up on this thing, there's treats involved. Pretty soon she's going to fly up there and help herself and think that's a great thing to be on and stand there. And when she gets a little older and big enough, you can shut the head gate on her. And she's still got goodies and treats in there, so it's still all good. You can start sitting next to her. Again, it's good. And then you can start rubbing your hands all over, especially in her nether region where her udder's going to be someday. And she gets used to that, and it's no big deal. It's all a good experience. So then, by the time she is pregnant and has her babies and she's in milk and it's 2 weeks into her lactation and you can start locking those babies up at night and getting some milk in the morning, the only thing she's got to learn at that point is you taking the milk and not the babies. And yeah, she's probably going to dance around a little bit and say, hey, what are you doing? And she might be uncomfortable because her milk might really come in and she might be really tight, but she'll learn. And pretty soon, again, she's going to associate the milk stand with a pleasant experience. Not only is she getting something to eat, you're relieving the pressure in her udder. It's all good. And there you've got a goat trained to the milk stand. And you didn't really have to train her. You just had to habitualize her to the routine. Goats are big animals on routine. So once you get them into something, they just naturally go with the flow. It's not a big deal. But don't start when she's full grown and in milk. Start when she's a baby, okay? All right, guys, I think I've talked your ear off enough. Hope this has been helpful to you. And Grace, his patience is up. We still gotta milk you yet, Grace.